Welcome to the Rock Church and World Outreach Center. We pray that this message will strengthen and encourage you. Now, here's a message from Pastor Dan Roth.
Today, get your Bibles out and go with me to the book of John, chapter number 12. We're going to start in John, chapter number 12 today as we continue our series on the blessed life. Now, today's message stands alone, but let me just remind you of some of the things we've been talking about. That way, some of you guys that maybe are new or you might have missed out, you can get where we're going. We've been talking about living a blessed life. All of us want to live a blessed life. The blessed life starts with the heart. Starts right here. It doesn't start with a checkbook. Doesn't start with a bank account. It starts with your heart. And we're going to live a blessed life. We've got to make sure that we're doing something. There was a test. You remember what the test was? It's tithing. Oh, my goodness. What? I didn't know there was going to be a test. But every time there's an opportunity to give, there's a test on our life called tithing. And if we're going to do that, we've got to put God first. There's a principle that when we put God first, everything else will come in line with what needs to happen. And finally, last time we were together, you remember we talked about breaking the spirit of mammon, that we can either have the spirit of God on our finances or we can have the spirit of mammon, that worldly spirit on our finances. And the way we break that spirit of mammon is we give that first portion to God, and now the blessing of God is on our finances, and now we can use it for building the kingdom of God, and now that spirit of mammon is off of our finances. Today I want to talk to you about a subject, and really it's a question for all of us. And the title of today's message is this: Am I generous? Am I generous? It's really a good question for all of us to ask. And after 20 years of being a Christian this coming August, I still ask myself this question, even though, yes, I've been a tither for 20 years. Yes, I've been giving. Yes, I've been generous. Yes, I've had opportunities to give large amounts and to do some great things with my finances over the year. I still struggle with this. I still look at this. There's times where something will happen, you know, you're dishing up food and you dish yourself a bigger portion than someone else because why? You're selfish, right? And I have to look at that plate and I have to say, well, am I generous? What am I doing, you know? And there might be areas in life when you see someone on the street that's in need of help, or maybe when you see somebody in church that's down on their luck, and you have those opportunities, and we have to take a moment and look at our lives and say, am I generous? Today, we're going to find out the answer to that question as we go throughout the Word of God. John chapter 12, great story that illustrates this for us. John chapter 12, we're going to start in verse number 1, and we're going to read through verse number 7. John chapter 12, starting in verse 1, says this: Then 6 days before the Passover, Jesus came to Bethany, where Lazarus was, who had been dead, whom he, speaking of Jesus, had raised from the dead. Now stop right there, we got to set the story for us, okay? You remember Jesus comes, and he's in a certain place, and they send word to him, they say, hey, Lazarus is really sick. Now, Jesus had a great healing ministry. All that Jesus touched, right, were healed. People, power went out from Jesus. Jesus could be just teaching, and power would zap, go out, and someone would get healed. There were miracles, signs, wonders. And so they sent word to Jesus, letting him know that his friend, Lazarus, was sick. And so Jesus waits. Eventually, Lazarus dies. Jesus knows about it. And the disciples are kind of wondering what's going on here, and yet Jesus is still waiting. Finally, he says, let's go up to Bethany. And they say, well, wait a second, Jesus, you can't go up there. The Jews are going to take you down. He says, no, we got to go there. This sickness is not, you know, just about sickness, but this is for the glory of God. And so they go up, and they go to that place, and Lazarus' two sisters come out to meet Jesus, right? And they say, you know what, Jesus, if you would have been here, my brother wouldn't be dead. You could have healed him. And Jesus says, I am the resurrection and the life. He who believes in me shall never die. She says, I know on the last day. And Jesus says, no, this is not about the last day. You're going to see the power of God. Remember the story, the very famous scripture, shortest scripture in the Bible. Jesus' heart is moved with compassion when he sees the people, sees the place where Lazarus lay, and Jesus weeps. And there he commands that the tomb be opened. They say, wait a second, Jesus, you can't open the tomb. There's going to be a stench by now. Jesus says, no, go ahead and open it up. And he cries out with a loud voice, Lazarus, come forth. Lazarus comes out bound in grave clothes. He says, I want you to release him. Now, here we are later on. They're in Bethany. Lazarus is sitting at the table who had been dead, whom Jesus had raised from the dead. Verse number 2. There they made him a supper, and Martha served. No surprise to any of us who know the story, right? Because Martha, that's what Martha does. Martha serves. Remember, she got all mad at Mary. Tell Jesus, you tell Mary. She's get up and start helping me in the kitchen. Jesus, wait a second, Martha. She's chosen the needful thing. She's listening to me. So here's Martha, once again, doing what Martha does. Martha served, but Lazarus was one of those who sat at the table with him. Verse number 3, then Mary. We see Mary doing what Mary does, right? Mary took a pound of very costly oil of spikenard. Everybody say costly. Oh, okay. Now, a third of you guys said that. Listen, if you want to live a blessed life, If you want to have a life of abundance and blessing, if you want to have this life that we're talking about today, it doesn't happen because you sat in church today. Okay, you could sit in church and be brain dead and walk out of this place and get nothing. But if you get involved and you get your heart in this and you start to apply the word of God, then you're going to live that blessed life. So come on, I need everybody in the place to say costly.
Costly.
Very costly oil of spikenard anointed the feet of Jesus and wiped his feet with her hair. That's pretty extravagant, isn't it? Pretty generous. And the house was filled with the fragrance of the oil. I love that section of scripture. I love how beautifully that displays what generosity does. See, there was a fragrance that went out from Mary's gift. Nobody was unaware of what happened. Why? Because the house was just filled with the fragrance. You would go, what's that? That smells good. What's going on? What was Mary doing under the wiping Jesus' feet with her hair? Oh, my goodness. Now, take a look at the next verse. But one of his disciples, verse number 4, Judas Iscariot, Simon's son, who would betray him, said, now we know who this guy is, all right? So you got the context of who this is saying this? All right, here we go. Verse number 5, why was this fragrant oil not sold for 300 denarii and given to the poor? Now that sounds pretty spiritual, doesn't it? That was a pretty good question. Wait a second, why is he giving this to Jesus, just wiping it on his feet? That's pretty extravagant. That's what a waste. This could have been sold given to the poor. Wow, Judas, you're so spiritual. Maybe you should be the leader. Look at the next verse. Verse number 6. This he said, not that he cared for the poor, but because he was a thief and had the money box, and he used to take what was put in it. Now, hold on a second. Anybody that says that Jesus didn't have any money while he was here on the earth is just wrong. You need to read your Bible. Look at what it says. It says that, first of all, Jesus had 12 disciples that traveled with him, right? Now, where do you think they got food? Where do you think they got clothes? Where do you think they got shelter, right? They had to pay for all that stuff, okay? So here he has a treasurer who had the money box, so therefore they had money. And as money went into it, Judas would take out of it, and they still had enough to live on. So Jesus apparently had enough wealth coming into his ministry, because traveling ministers need to have finances in order to do what they need to do. And so Jesus had enough money that Judas could take out of the box and they still would be provided for. Okay? So Jesus had wealth while he was here on the earth, and he used it wisely to build the kingdom of God. And yet this guy could be a thief and he could take from it and they still had their needs met. Now let's read on. Look at what the next verse, verse number 7. But Jesus said, let her alone, for she has kept this for the day of my burial. He rebukes Judas, tells him this is something that was done for me. Now, two questions come up when I read this. First of all, why was Judas so upset? Pretty simple answer. We read about it. We understand that on a surface level, okay? So that's question number one. Why was Judas so upset? But secondly, why would Mary give such an extravagant and generous gift? Now, I'm going to put a statement up for you on the overhead. Those of you that are taking notes can write this down. Those of you that aren't taking notes can start taking some notes, all right? Start writing some stuff down, type it out in your phone, whatever you need to do so you can remember this. Our giving reveals our heart. Our giving reveals our heart. Two kinds of hearts you see here, okay? First one that you see is a generous heart. Mary broke open this very costly oil of spikenard, poured it out on the feet of Jesus, and was wiping his feet with her hair. Very generous heart. Second heart that you see is this, a selfish heart. Selfish heart, because he was stealing and wanted that money for himself. Now, a couple of things that today, as we take a look at generosity, I want to point out to you, first of all, is this, is that the enemy of generosity is selfishness. That if we're going to have a generous heart, which I believe that each and every one of us want to have a generous heart, that there is an enemy that's going to come against you, and that enemy of generosity is selfishness. Turn your Bible with me this time to 1 John. 1 John this time. And in 1 John, we're going to take a look at chapter number 3. 1 John chapter number 3, and this time verse number 17. 1 John chapter 3, verse number 17. Look at what it says. It says, but whoever has this world's goods and sees his brother in need and shuts up his heart from him, how does the love of God abide in him? I love how the old King James says it. It says that he shuts up his bowels of compassion. See, God is asking us, are you generous? And the enemy of generosity is selfishness. You could have something, and as you have that thing, you could see someone else in need, and now all of a sudden the opportunity arises, and there's going to be that little voice that says, if you give, you won't have. If you give, you'll lack. If you give, it's going to hurt. You just got that. You need it. It would be foolish to give it away. And yet God is saying, I want you to allow the grace of God, the love of God to flow in and through you. See, you were born selfish, like we said before, but you were born again generous. You now have the new nature of God on the inside of you. God is now your Father, and you can choose to act like God and be generous, or you can choose to be like the devil and be selfish. See, he was your father. You remember this? What's one of the first words that children learn how to say clearly at a young age? Mine. Right? Mine. And normally when you hear it, it's not just mine. It's at a very high pitch, and there's a nerve that runs up the back of your head, down through your eyeball, and into your mouth. And somehow when they're saying it rapidly at this same high pitch, mine, 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 that nerve just starts to twitch. You just start to, And so you run into the room and you see normally it's the younger one with something of the older ones, right? And they're pulling on it, mine, 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 mine. And there's a moment where parents no longer care about justice any longer. Is that right, parents? What do you care about? You care about quiet. And so you run into the room, you see, mine, mine, mine. You say, just give it to her. And the older one says, but Dad, really, it really is mine. And I was playing. No, just listen, they got stuff of mine too. Just give it to her. I want to quiet this house. Do you ever stop to think that maybe God uses the word mine on purpose when it comes to the tithe because he's getting our attention? The tithe belongs to me. It's mine. So that when we look at, am I generous or am I selfish, God is saying, that's mine. Will you bring it into the house of God? See, God wants us to be like him. Now, when we look at extravagance, right? Extravagance. Talking about extravagant gifts. Here, Mary poured out an extravagant gift. You know what extravagance is in the world, the worldly definition of extravagance? That's anything that's better than mine. Oh, look at that person's car. Why do they need such a car? My car gets me from A to B. That's all I need. That's extravagant. They should sell that car and give the money to the poor. You remember who originated that statement, right? Come on, somebody. Any house that's better than yours. I don't understand why they need so many square feet. Gosh, I love my house. My house is great. Until you get a raise and you move into that neighborhood. Then you say, I don't know how we lived like that. That was cramping us. That was terrible. This is what we needed. And then you start looking at the other house up on the hill and you say, I don't know why they need a house like that. They should sell that house and give the money to the poor. But see, if you cared about the poor, you would sell your house and give the money to the poor. I'll stop meddling, okay? It's fine. All right, I'll move on that way. At the back door, you can say good message and you won't hate me. But listen, did God know who had the money box? Jesus knew that Judas had the money box, right? Who's the leader of the bunch? Jesus. So either Jesus gave him the job or he knew that he had the job and was allowing him to do it. Now, did Jesus know that he was skimming? Yeah, of course he did. Jesus knows everything. He's God in the flesh. So he knew. So why would he allow him to have that if he knew that he was going to fail? See, God tests us in the area of finance, not tempts us. God doesn't tempt us with sin. The Lord himself cannot be tempted, right? So he doesn't tempt us, but he will give us a way of escape when we're tempted, but God will test our hearts. Do you think that Jesus was giving him an opportunity not to fail, but to pass? See, that same opportunity comes into our lives. Today, if we were passing the offering and you were looking at the buckets, how many of you would say, I would gladly just take some money right out of that bucket? We would all go, oh, there's no way. Oh, my goodness, that would be horrible. You'd be a thief. You're stealing God's money. There's a curse on you if you steal God's money. But the same thing happens when we hold back what belongs to God in our account and we don't bring it. Is that right? See, we can either be blessed in our finances by giving and being generous, or we can be cursed. Let's move on. It's quiet in this place. Our giving reveals our heart, and the enemy of generosity is selfishness. Second thing about generosity is this, the extravagance of generosity. We've been using this term, extravagance. You know, you can find extravagant gifts in the Bible. God gave Jesus, right? That was the most lavish, most extravagant gift. Listen, we deserved hell. God would have been just in sending us to hell. If God would have said, you're a whelp, and I'm just casting you out of my presence, and you're going to burn in eternity for hell, he would be just in doing so. But now here he is, and he loves us so much that he sends Jesus beaten, bloody, hung on a cross. The darling of heaven, broken from the Father's side, the one and only, the begotten Son of God, now here, given for you and for me. God wouldn't even withhold his Son from us. God, it's too much. God, I don't deserve it. God, I'm not worthy, God. And yet he says, you're worth it to me because I love you and I want you in my presence. What an extravagant gift God gave. What other extravagant gifts do we see in the Bible? What about King David? Remember when King David was given of his own personal treasuries to the house of the Lord? You know, if you added up all the gems and the stones and the gold and the silver and the bronze and the wood and the fine linens and all the stuff that David gave for building the house of the Lord, as well as the hired laborers and all that, it would add up to, in today's value, $21 billion. Not million, billion with a B, all right? $21 billion. I would say that's a pretty extravagant gift. You know, you see another extravagant gift in the New Testament. There was a widow that gave two mites. That's not even worth a penny in our day. Wait a second, $21 billion, not even a penny? Yeah, because Jesus looked at it. He saw this woman give two mites, and what did he do? He called a staff meeting right there at the offering plate, right? Hey, boys, come on over here. Let's take a look at this widow's offering. How'd you like it if today you were given and all of a sudden I said, oh, hold on, Rock Church staff, can you come over here and let's take a look at Joe's offering? You'd be like, what? No, Pastor, don't look at the couple of quarters I popped in the plate. You know, I know you heard it when they dropped in there, but please don't embarrass me. But what did Jesus say? He said, everybody else gave out of their abundance. She gave out of her poverty all that she had. She gave everything. Wow, that's extravagance. How about Mary in this story? 300 denarii worth, a very costly oil of spikenard. What is that? A denarius was one day's wages. So 300 denarii would actually be a whole year's worth of wages. You took out weekends, right? You would have a full year. Think about it in these terms. Take a moment and think about your yearly salary. What do you make in one year, okay? It's pretty valuable to you, right? That's what you have to live off of. Now think about saving that up and taking that year's salary, liquefying it and pouring it onto somebody's feet. That's what Mary did. 1 year of her life, 1 year of her effort, 1 year of her energy, 1 year of her salary now poured out on the feet of Jesus. But remember, Jesus said, leave her alone. She's done this for my burial. You know, Jesus, he didn't have another anointing for his burial. Think about that for a second. No one else got to anoint Jesus for his burial except for Mary. Why? Because the day of preparation, you remember they came and they wanted to, but at the day of preparation, they had to hurry up. That's why they had to break the guy's legs out there on the cross. It's because when they were pushing up, they would push up so that they wouldn't get asphyxiated and suffocate to death. Really, that's how crucifixion killed you, was the suffocation. So they would push up to breathe air, and then they would go back down. And then when they would start to feel the need, they'd push up. So they broke their legs so that now they couldn't push up anymore and they had to die quicker. But Jesus was already dead, so they couldn't anoint his body then. So then he's laid in the grave on the first day of the week, Sunday morning. Here come the women with 100 pounds of spices, right? They're going to anoint the body of Jesus. But he'd already checked out of the room. Is that right? He'd risen. He's gone. So the only anointing Jesus was going to get was this extravagant gift from Mary. Now, could we give an extravagant gift to God? Is there something that we could bring to God that God would say, wow, that's extravagant? Could we give all of our money? Could we give $21 billion? No, I don't think any of us could, right? But you know what God's really after? He's after you. 2 Corinthians chapter 8, verse number 5, talking about offerings given by a people who are in a very poor community. In fact, they were in a recession much like the Inland Empire has been in since 2008, barely scraping out of. And he says that they gave, and look at what he says in 2 Corinthians chapter 8, verse 5, and not only as we had hoped, but they first gave themselves to the Lord and then to us by the will of God. See, if we're going to give God an extravagant gift, it has to start with your heart. It has to start with what he really wants. It has to start with you, and it has to start with me. Now, let me tell you about something, the three levels of giving. See, if we're going to get to an extravagant gift, we have to start with the first level of giving. And there are three levels of giving that you will see in the Bible. First level of giving is this, tithes. You'll see that in the Bible. As a tithe, that's the basics, okay? That's the first level of giving because God says it's mine. I want you to bring it to me, okay? Second level of giving is offerings over and above the tithe now, right? Third level of giving is extravagant offerings. Or someone said it like this, painful offerings, okay? And anybody that's ever given one of those knows what I'm talking about when I say painful offerings. I remember one time we had Marilyn Skinner come from Wetoto. In fact, Pastor Jim was just talking about this, I believe, last Sunday night. And how when Marilyn came, she was talking about how they take care of the widows and the orphans at Wetoto there in Africa and Uganda. And so here they are, and they've been, you know, they have these child soldiers, and they've been ravaged by AIDS and all sorts of civil war and all sorts of things going on. And there's genocides all around and things taking place. And so here they are in the midst of all this, taking care of the widow and the orphan. Pastor is so moved, he gets up here with tears in his eyes, and he says, I'm not going to pastor a church that's not generous. And we're going to take care of these widows and orphans. And he says, I'm selling my boat. Now, for most of us, you know, in this room, we didn't really understand what that meant to him, but he had a friend that he had given $250 million worth of business in referrals, $250 million. And because this guy was so grateful and so thankful, he says, you know what, really, I want to give you a gift. Can I buy you a helicopter? And Pastor looked at Pastor Deborah and she said, mm-mm. And so he said, no, I can't receive a helicopter from you, you know. What about a boat? You know, I like to sail. You want to buy me a boat? And so a guy bought him a boat, and he loved that boat. His first boat, free and clear, bought it for him. He had learned to sail, and now here he is. He has a boat, and he says, I'm selling my boat. He took this thing that he loved, took this thing that he enjoyed, took this thing that was given to him. It was a very costly gift, and he sold and he sent the money to a total. He said, I want you guys to figure out what you're going to do because we as a church are going to take care of this together. So I was sitting there, and my wife and I, we talked. We had some savings. We had, you know, some things we were going to do monthly, that sort of a thing. And so we're talking, and then God said, I want you to give an extravagant gift. Not just tithes, not just offerings, not just what you can do. I want you to go over and above. And I said, okay, Lord, what are you thinking about? God reminded me that I had four guitars in my house. Now, listen, you can only play one guitar at a time, unless you're very skilled with your feet or something like that. I don't know, you know, so... So I had a couple of guitars, and there were two that I played mainly because they were the best ones. And so, you know, I was using them here at the church, playing Wednesday nights, that sort of a thing. And I liked those guitars, enjoyed them. They sound good, and they play well. But I still had been holding on to my first guitars. I got one for my birthday, and I got one as a reward. It was the one that I really loved the most. It was a white Fender Stratocaster guitar. Had a rosewood fretboard. It was actually, you guys remember the movie Wayne's World? You guys remember that movie? Wayne's World, party time, excellent. Okay, so anyways, it was the replica of the movie. Remember they had it up in the glass case, and they had the sign next to it, No Stairway to Heaven, right? And so it was the replica, and in fact, on the back of this guitar, because it was the replica, on the plate that held the body to the neck, it had an inscription, the Wayne's World logo. Just engraved there on that plate. And so I loved that guitar. I got that guitar for learning how to play. I had enjoyed playing on that guitar and still had, it was dirt, you know, my fingerprints and that sort of thing, but I loved it. So God says, I want you to give that guitar up. Ouch. Lord, this is my prized guitar. You know, this was a reward for learning. It's sentimental. You know, I know it may not be much, but God, it's the Wayne's World logo on it. God says, give it. I said, okay, yes, sir. So I took my guitar that I got for my birthday, acoustic. You know, I was thinking I was getting $10 for it at the pawn shop, right? And they gave me $20. Hallelujah, double your money. And then I'm dragging my feet on this other guitar. I'm going, God, what am I going to do with this, you know? Where am I going to sell it? I take it over to Guitar Center, and I'm thinking, you know, okay, probably get maybe $1,000. It's worth $1,500, you know? So take it in there and take it to the guy. Said, I'd like to sell this guitar. He says, okay, let me take a look at it. He starts looking at it. I said, you know, rosewood fretboard, nice creamy white. It's the replica from the movie. Flip it over. Look at the back. That's got to be worth something. He says, yeah, actually, I think so. You know, I haven't seen one of these before. Ah, cha-ching. $2,000 maybe. $2,500. I hadn't seen one before. Got to be unique. Okay, let's do this, you know. So he starts looking it up on the computer. He says, okay, I see some online sales. I see some of these selling in Canada. All right. Hey, okay, they're selling. Cool. Maybe $3,000, you know, this is, okay, God, this doesn't hurt so bad. The guy looks at me and he says, I'll give you $200 for it. Let me get that out of my back here for a second. I'm sorry, what did you say? You meant 1,000, right? No, $200 for it. That's what they're selling for. Is that Canadian or American? You know, because there is a difference. You might need to, God says sell it. Okay, Lord. So I sold it, sent the money to Ototo. See, it's not about amount. It's about heart. God is looking for a generous heart that won't withhold, that won't hold in those bowels of compassion, but that will open up the hand and give with extravagance. That's what the Lord is looking for. He's looking for your heart first. Can you say amen today? Now quickly, because the preacher's preaching too long, let me tell you the rest of the story, okay? The rest of the story is I had a buddy that heard that I had sold the guitar, and he went down the very next day to the Guitar Center to buy the guitar. He got there first thing in the morning because he thought everybody from church that had heard about this was going to be there to buy the guitar and do the same thing he was doing. None of you guys were there. I don't know what's wrong with any of you guys. Okay? But he had a generous heart. And so he went and he took out credit because he couldn't afford to buy it. And he bought that guitar probably for $200, probably $250, $300 based on them making a profit on it. And he paid that guitar off and he sat on it for 5 years. Sucker. 5 years he sits on it, and then finally he brings it to my house on Christmas. And he brings it out in a box, and I got a picture of it. I could show it to you later on, but I didn't bring it with me today. But my face was just stark white. I could not believe, because I opened it up, and that looks like my, wait a second, that's my dirt. It's my fingerprints. That's the Wayne's World logo. What? You know? He had waited, and he brought it back to me. Now, he told me, now, this is not your guitar. I'm just loaning this to you so you can never give it away again. So that's my guitar, but you get to keep it in your house. So I have a borrowed guitar in my house now that the Lord brought back to me. Which brings us to number three, is the reward of generosity. The reward of generosity. See, Mary didn't come to get a reward. She came to give. She came because she loved the Lord. She came to anoint the feet of Jesus. But why would she give such a gift? See, we answered the first question about Judas, right? We found out that Judas had a selfish heart. He was skimming off the top, and he wasn't mad about the poor not being taken care of. He was mad that he didn't get to steal part of that wage, or if not the whole wage that was coming into the money box. It was a selfish heart. That's why he got so upset. But why would Mary give such an extravagant gift? Well, you remember the very first verse that we read? Lazarus, who had been dead, whom Jesus had raised from the dead, who is now seated at the table with Jesus. See, that was Mary's brother. And Mary came with a grateful heart because her brother was dead. And now he's alive. And because, what price do you put on that? Now, I'm going to give my whole life because I love the Lord Jesus. And she broke open her gift, and that extravagant gift was poured out on Jesus, and she was able to do something. Now, did she get a reward? Did she get a year's wages back? No. We don't see that in finances, but the reward is not finance. The blessing may be finances. The blessing may be material things, but the reward comes back in greater measure. Take a look with me at Mark chapter 14, verse number 9. I'll put it up on the overheads for you. Same story, same thing going on. Look at what Jesus says. He says, assuredly I say to you, wherever this gospel is preached in the whole world, what this woman has done will also be told as a memorial to her. Did you catch that? The whole world. Think about it this way. For thousands of years, all over the world, in multiple languages, wherever the gospel is preached, when people are talking about this story, they are talking about Mary and the very costly gift that she broke open and poured out on the feet of Jesus, and that's being told not as a memorial to Jesus, but as a memorial to her. That was her reward. See, that comes back in a greater measure. What price can you put on that? But let me say it to you this way. Generosity is the expression of a grateful heart. See, when you love the Lord and when you realize I was dead, but now I'm alive. My family, my brother, my sister, my mom, my dad, my auntie, my uncle, they were dead in their trespasses and sins. And yet now Jesus has raised them to life. He got them off the street. He changed their heart. He cleaned them up. He stopped them from chasing money and chasing women and chasing men and chasing dreams, chasing all sorts of empty things. And now they're chasing Jesus. What price do you put on that? But God, I'm grateful. And God, I love you. Therefore, out of my heart and out of my life, God, I'm going to pour out an extravagant gift on you, God, because I'm grateful. See, a generous heart is one that gives, desiring nothing in return. Now, I want you to notice what I said, desiring nothing in return. You can expect a reward. And I'll teach you about this in a second. But your desire is, God, I just love you, and I'm grateful. Therefore, God, I'm going to give. But a selfish heart gives and thinks that God owes him something. Like Judas sold Jesus for 30 pieces of silver. See, when you give with that heart, God can't help but reward you. When you give with a generous heart, God says, I have to reward him. Why? Because God is a rewarder. Hebrews 11:6, you remember it? Without faith, it's impossible to please him. For he who comes to God must believe that he is, and that he is a what? Oh, come on, you guys didn't check out, did you? And that he's a what? And that he's a rewarder of those who diligently seek him. This is the only place in the Bible you will find this Greek word, rewarder. It is a five-syllable word. Four of those five syllables mean to pay what is due. But that fifth little syllable changes the meaning of the word to mean this: to pay what is due extravagantly, lavishly, over and above in abundance. God is a rewarder of those who diligently seek him. Now, let me use a double negative to illustrate this point for you. God cannot not reward you. Did you get that? God cannot not reward you. Why? Because it's his nature. He is a rewarder. Just like he is the person of truth, God cannot lie to you. Just like God is love, therefore God cannot not love you. In the same way, when you are generous and when you give that lavish gift to God, desiring nothing in return, you can still expect a reward. Why? Because God is a rewarder of those who diligently seek him. He cannot not reward you. Come on. Hallelujah. God is not rewarding the amount, but he's rewarding the heart. God is looking to bless your life. And the blessed life starts with a generous heart. Let's just have everybody bow their heads and close their eyes for a moment. And I want you to just think, what is God speaking to me? Just ask yourself that question right now. Take a moment and listen. What is it that the Lord is speaking to you? Now, I want you to take a moment and just write that down, what God spoke to you. Just write it down. Quickly commit it to paper. Commit it to your phone, the notes in your phone, maybe the notes on your tablet, whatever you have. Just write it down. Make a mental note of it, whatever you need to do. Now there's accountability. Now you have something. What is God speaking to you? Husbands and wives, maybe you want to whisper in each other's ears right now. This is what God just spoke to me. Just take a moment, whisper it into your spouse's ear. This is what God is speaking to me. Now you guys can get in agreement. There's power in agreement. Now everybody look up here and put a smile on your face. Isn't God good? Did you guys get something from the word of the Lord today? Hallelujah. I want to talk to you guys about your life before you leave this place. It'd be a tragedy if we came into the house of God and had such a good time like we did. Laughed and sang and experienced the presence of God. Celebrated Father's today. That's wonderful. It'd be a tragedy if we did all that and then you left this place and your heart wasn't right with God. You died and you went to hell. I don't want that. You don't want that. But did you know that more than both of us, God doesn't want that? Sometimes people say, well, Pastor, I don't believe in hell. Well, you know, the Bible talks about hell. Old and New Testament. Jesus himself spoke of it. It's a very real place. And just by burying your head in the sand doesn't make it go away. You're going to have to face the reality of it. Let's make sure today that you don't end up there. You say, well, Pastor, don't all roads lead to heaven? Well, let's apply that logic to the earth. Okay? All roads lead to the moon. You'd say, you're crazy. You can drive around the earth as long as you want and you'll never make it to the moon. Well, then why would we apply that to heaven? See, you're not going to make it just because you know something about God or you have a system of beliefs or something like that. All the world religions out there, you know, everybody has their own thing and they're all going to make it somewhere, some way. No, the Bible says wide is the road that leads to destruction. But narrow is the path that leads to life, and there are few who find it. Today, can I show you the path? Don't you think God, the creator of the heavens and the earth, the one who wrote the plan of redemption, carried it out in his son, Jesus, beaten bloody and hung on a cross, public spectacle for all to see. You think after he does all that, he says, yeah, whatever you want to do, just do your thing and I'll see you in heaven. No, he doesn't. He tells us exactly how to get to heaven right here in his word. Jesus said it like this. He said, you must be born again. Now, I know when I use that term, being born again, a lot of people get confused or they get disgusted and they say, oh, I heard about that. You know, I read about it on a blog or I saw it in a movie and I really didn't like it and I don't want to have any part of it. Well, listen, let's not let the world define for us a biblical term. What does being born again really mean from the Bible? Well, from the beginning of the Bible to the end of the Bible, it's always meant the same thing. It means that you've given God all of your heart and you've given God all of your life. It's just that simple. Because you can't earn your way into heaven. You can't be good enough, attend enough church, be born in America because America is the Christian nation. You can't volunteer enough or memorize enough scripture, give enough money in order to earn your way into heaven. See, if you were going to earn your way into heaven, you know what the standard is? Perfection. The only one who is perfect, his name is Jesus. So because we fall short, God says you must be born again. Now, we don't understand that. We say, well, what does that mean? It means that you've given God all of your heart. You've given God all of your life. You remember the scripture from 2 Corinthians 8, verse number 5, that they gave themselves first to the Lord. See, God really wants all of you. He wants you. Above all else, God wants your heart and your life. You know why? Because he already gave you his heart. He already gave you his life. He didn't withhold any of it. And therefore, if you know that it's been a religious thing for you, it's been just a tradition, well, my parents went to church, so I go to church, you know. But you haven't yet had that real relationship with Jesus. Maybe it's for you, it's been, you know, just kind of a lukewarm thing, a little in, little out, little up, little down, a little token prayer every now and again, an occasional church attendance. And God is something in your life, but he's not everything. You're not opposed to God, but you're not wholehearted for God. Listen, you're not going to make it. And can I love you enough, respect you enough, and honor you enough to tell you the truth? That's not real Christianity. Why? Because think about it. Jesus said it like this. He said, when I come, I want to find you hot or cold, because if I find you lukewarm, I'll vomit you from my mouth. What does that mean? That's pretty gross, graphic words from the mouth of Jesus. That means that people that call themselves Christians that are lukewarm are not real Christians at all. They're going to get ejected and rejected from the body of Christ. So today I want to give you an opportunity. In a moment, I'm going to count to three just like this. One, two, three, bang, pop my hands together. When you hear the sound of my hands popping together just like that, bang, that's your opportunity to give God all of your heart and all of your life. All you have to do, if you want to do that, is simply raise your hand. What you're doing by the raising of your hand is you're saying something. You're saying, I want to give God all my heart, I want to give God all my life, I want to be born again, headed for heaven, denying my presence in hell. I'll see your hand go up, I'll count it, you can put it right back down. You say, well, Pastor, wait a second, come on. I mean, I'll be embarrassed if I raise my hand. Uh-huh, you might be. Let's push past that today. Why? Because think of the trade-off. Isn't it better to be embarrassed for a moment than it is to end up in hell forever and ever and ever? Don't want to make that trade. Moment of possible embarrassment for an eternity in hell away from God. Come on, no one's that dumb. And yet the devil thinks that you are. That's why he's trying to talk you out of it. That's why he's pushing you away from it. That's why I'm pushing you towards it right now. It's because I love you and I want you to have a real relationship with Jesus Christ, real relationship with God, and a real destiny and future in heaven with him, denying your presence in hell. Jesus said, if you confess me before men, I'll confess you before my Father who is in heaven. But if you deny me, I will deny you. Today, your call, your choice. You can sit there and do nothing, and you've made your choice, or you can get right with God by simply raising your hand. Probably won't even be embarrassed. This is a safe and friendly place. We're all rooting for you. We're all excited for you. And maybe dad, your children brought you today. Man, they want you to do this. They're not going to be ashamed of you if you raise your hand. Dad, maybe you brought the family, and family, you're wondering, why was dad so persistent today? Here's the reason why. Dad loves you. And dad wants you in heaven. Today, there's no shame. Dad's not looking down on you. Dad's excited for you, okay? You can give God all of your heart. You can give God all of your life in this safe and friendly church service. Now, who should raise their hand? Who? Am I talking to you? Yeah, I'm talking to you. If you've never done this, come on, it's time to do it. Time to get right with God. Maybe you've been running from God instead of to God. Come on, I'm speaking to you. Maybe you're not sure. You're just sitting there kind of scratching your head going, I really don't know. Well, listen, today, make sure before you leave this place. Or finally, if you're lukewarm in this place, you know that's the condition of your heart when I described it. Get ready to get your hand up. All across this auditorium, back in the family rooms, wherever you're at, watching by television in the foyer, down at the Love Rock Cafe, come on, put the burger down. Get ready to get your hand up. If you're watching online by live stream, get ready to get your hand up. God sees, God's watching, and he will notice that your hand is going up right now. And then right afterwards, minimize your video browser. There's a blue button that says respond to God or go to our homepage and click how to know God, and someone will lead you in a prayer. I'm going to count to three, pop my hands together. This is your time. This is your moment of salvation. Here we go, all together, wherever you're at, get ready. If you need to do this, get ready to get your hand up. One, two, three. Let me see your hands. Just raise them up high for me right now. There's one, two, three, four, five. Thank you. God bless you. There's six. There's seven. Got you up there. Thank you. Eight. Got you over here. Eight wise people already. Anybody else back in that family room? Eight wise people already on this side. Got eight wise people. Can I have a little bit of lights, guys? I'm having a little bit of trouble seeing some of the hands. Eight, nine. Thank you. God bless you. Is that a hand up there? Wave it at me if it is. About eight or nine wise people. Anybody else real quick? I got you. If there are two hands raised, just giving their heart and life to Jesus. That's awesome. That's awesome. Anybody else real quick? I didn't embarrass them and I won't embarrass you. Nine. Oh, 10. Got you over there. Thank you. God bless you. On this side. 11 over here. God bless you. Anybody else real quick? I'm going to wrap this thing up in a moment. I don't want you to miss out. Thank you. Number 12. Got you back there in the family room. Got you, man. God is so good. Anybody else real quick? Anybody else? Just lift them up high for me when I'm looking your direction. Anybody else? Thank you, number 13. Thank you, number 14. Got you up there. Thank you, number 15 up on top. Got you over there. Anybody else real quick? Anybody else real quick? All right, let's give the Lord a great big praise for 15 wise people. Hallelujah. Woo. So exciting. Quickly, because the preacher talked way too much today. I want you to quickly get your stuff, whatever you brought with you to church, coat, purse, sweater, Bible, a friend if you need a friend. I want you to get in the aisle and meet me up front because we're going to change destinies today. Can't do that until we get you down here. So if you raised your hand or you should have raised your hand, it's not too late. Get your stuff, get a friend if you need a friend, get in the aisle and meet me up front. You come right now. Let's stand and welcome them. And you come. Come on down. Come on down.
Just as I am without.
They're coming. Come on. Let's give them a hand as they come.
But that thy blood was shed for me.
From the family rooms, if you want to bring your children, they're welcome. Come on, bring them down at this time. Come on down.
Come to thee, O Lamb of God, I come.
They're still coming. Come on, you can come too from the foyer. If you raised your hand out there, come on in. From up on top, make your way down right now. Come on down. From the family rooms, come on. We'll wait for you. They're still coming. They're still coming. Come on, you can come too. All right, thank God you guys have come, but give me just one moment, okay? Can I tell you the honest truth? You don't get saved by raising your hand and wanting Jesus. That's one thing, okay? You get saved by giving God all of your heart and all of your life. And we want to lead you in a prayer that'll do just that. We want to encourage you in your walk with God. And there's no shame in this, okay? And if you raised your hand but you were embarrassed to come, listen, you're not going to make it out there in the world because you're going to get in the marketplace or in the workplace. Someone's going to be talking about Christians. And you're just going to kind of go the way of the world. And remember, lukewarm Christianity is not real Christianity at all. And if you can't serve God and do the will of God in a safe and friendly church service like this, what makes you think you're going to live for Jesus outside of the walls of this church? And I want to encourage you, be bold. Be courageous in this place. We're all rooting you on. All of heaven, actually, is rooting you on right now. You've got God on your side. And I just want to encourage you, we're going to sing that song one more time. And as we do, if you raised your hand or you should have raised your hand, there's that internal struggle going on right now. I want you to cross over into faith. Let's believe God together. We love you and we want you to be a part of this. I don't want you to miss out. Would you just take some courage right now and step out into the aisle and come forward right now? Let's sing that. And you come, if that's you, you raise your hand or you should have raised your hand. Just come on down right now. Come on, let's welcome them. Come on, you can come. You can do this. You can do this.
But that thy blood was shed for me.
Come on.
And that thou biddest me come. to thee, O Lamb of God, I come.
Well, you guys came, and praise God for you guys. Put a big smile on your face. This is the best decision of your entire life right now, okay? Right over here to my right, your left, this is Pastor Joel, okay? He's a really good guy. Nothing weird's going to go on. Oh, look at, they're coming. Look at you guys. All right. All right. Come on down. Come on down. It's okay. Come on. So cool. So cool. Now, Pastor Joel, really good guy. Nothing weird's going to go on. You know, sometimes you go to church, you wonder, are they weird? I'm about as weird as you're going to get today, okay? He's cool. All right? He's going to do three things. He's going to lead you in a prayer to invite Jesus in your heart. You're going to be born again. He's going to give you some free information, some free literature, find out what to do next in your walk with God now that you're a Christian. And then finally, he's going to introduce you to a program we have here called Spiritual Personal Trainers. Basically, it's a friend in church who will help you to get strong in the ways of the Lord. Then I'll let you come right back out. Your friends and family will wait for you. So if you guys make a left turn, follow Pastor Joel right this way. Let's give him a hand. Ziggo. Hallelujah. God good.
Hey, you just heard that altar call. You just wanted to give God all of your heart and all of your life. Now let me lead you simply in a prayer of inviting Jesus Christ into your heart as your Lord and Savior. In fact, why don't you just go ahead and listen to me and go ahead and close your eyes and just repeat these words after me. I'll go slow. You repeat them. Say these words. Say, Father God, I come to you in the name of Jesus. I believe that Jesus Christ is your only begotten Son and that you sent him for me and that he died for me on that cross at Calvary. I believe that his blood washes away my sins, that I am now a new creature in Christ Jesus. And I thank you, Lord. I receive you now and forever as my Lord and as my Savior. I'm going to turn from sin, and I'm going to turn with all of my heart and all of my life to you, Jesus, as my Lord and as my Savior. Let it be known in heaven as well as upon the earth that I am born again. I'm a child of God, that I'm saved, and I'm headed for heaven and denying my presence in hell. Thank you, Jesus. I'm alive forevermore. Love you so much. God bless you guys. Everybody just say amen and receive Christ as your Lord and Savior. So talk to you later. God bless you.
Thank you for listening to the Rock Church and World Outreach Center. If this message spoke to you, please share it with us. We'd love to hear from you. You can find more information at www.rockchurch.com.